Are you sexually active? You have been sexually active from maybe 16 or 18 years, and now you are 25 to 30 years, and you have never gotten a pap smear or HPV vaccine. Please go get the vaccine ASAP or go for a pap smear because you might be at a risk of cervical cancer. I am not trying to scare you. I am trying to save you from a probable future pain because as of 2020, cervical cancer has claimed the lives of almost 350,000 women. You don't know what cervical cancer is. And why I said you might be at risk. Then you have to watch this video to the end because I will be covering everything you need to learn about cervical cancer in this video, starting from what it is, how it develops, causes and risk factors, symptoms, types and stages, complications, prevention and treatment. I know that it's a lot, but I will do my best to make it as simple as I can so that you can understand it easily. If at the end you feel this video is informative, please do me a favor and subscribe to the channel and also like for more informative videos. Hi, if you are new to my channel, I am V, and welcome to the best health channel on YouTube where we talk about everything related to your health and well-being. What is cervical cancer, you may ask? Cervical cancer is a type of cancer that occurs in the cells of the cervix, the lower part of the uterus that connects to the vagina. It's one of the cancers that can be significantly impacted by early detection and prevention measures, making it a key area of focus for women's health initiatives worldwide. How does cervical cancer develop? Cervical cancer typically develops very slowly over time. It begins as a precancerous condition known as dysplasia. This condition can be detected through regular pap smear tests and is 100% treatable, effectively preventing the development of cancer. The transition from dysplasia to full-blown cervical cancer can take several years, although it can happen faster in some women. At the heart of most cervical cancer cases is the human papillomavirus, HPV. HPV is a common virus transmitted through sexual contact. There are many types of HPV, but only a few lead to cervical cancer. The two main types of cervical cancer are squamous cell carcinoma. This type accounts for approximately 90% of cases and originates in the thin, flat cells, squamous cells, lining the outer part of the cervix, which projects into the vagina. Adenocarcinoma. This type develops from the glandular cells that line the cervical canal. Some cervical cancers have features of both types and are known as mixed carcinoma. Cervical cancer is primarily caused by persistent infection with certain types of human papillomavirus, HPV, but several other factors can influence the risk of developing the disease. So pay attention to them. High-risk human papillomavirus, HPV, infections. The primary cause of cervical cancer is a persistent infection with one of the high-risk types of HPV, notably types 16 and 18. These viruses can lead to changes in the cervical cells that may progress to cancer if not cleared by the immune system. Smoking. Women who smoke are about twice as likely as non-smokers to get cervical cancer. Smoking exposes the body to many cancer-causing chemicals that affect not only the lungs but also other parts of the body, including the cervix. Immunosuppression. Having a weakened immune system, such as from HIV, AIDS, or taking immunosuppressive drugs following organ transplantation, can increase the risk of HPV persistence and progression to cervical cancer. Sexual history. Early sexual activity and having multiple sexual partners increase the risk of HPV infection, which in turn can increase the risk of cervical cancer. This can also lead to several sexually transmitted diseases. So, do yourself a favor and stay loyal, and if you can't, at least get the HPV vaccine and go for pap smear every 3 years. Long-term use of oral contraceptives. Research has shown that the use of oral contraceptives for a long time, 5 years or more, may be associated with an increased risk of cervical cancer, possibly due to either increased exposure to HPV or an effect of the hormones on the cervix, so try to switch to other contraceptive measures and do not rely solely on oral contraceptives. Multiple full-term pregnancies. Women who have had 3 or more full-term pregnancies may have an increased risk of developing cervical cancer. The reasons behind this are not entirely clear but may relate to hormonal changes during pregnancy and possible increased exposure to HPV. Early age at first full-term pregnancy. Women who were younger than 17 years when they had their first full-term pregnancy are at a higher risk of cervical cancer compared to those who were 25 years or older. Family history of cervical cancer. Having a mother or sister who has had cervical cancer can increase a woman's risk of developing the disease, suggesting a possible genetic predisposition. Understanding these causes and risk factors can help in developing strategies for prevention, including lifestyle changes, HPV vaccination, and regular cervical cancer screening to detect precancerous changes early. Now you understand what cervical cancer is, how it develops, the causes and risk factors, but how can you detect it? What are the signs your body gives you when it starts to manifest? I really need you to pay attention to this part and also be more aware of what is happening to your body. Cervical cancer in its early stages often presents with no symptoms, which is why regular screening is crucial for early detection. However, as the disease progresses, several symptoms may appear. Symptoms like abnormal vaginal bleeding. This is the most common symptom. It may occur between menstrual periods, after sexual intercourse, after menopause, or after a pelvic exam. The bleeding is typically not associated with pain and can vary in severity. Unusual vaginal discharge. Women with cervical cancer may experience a watery, pink, or foul-smelling discharge. The discharge may be heavy and occur at any time during the menstrual cycle. Pelvic pain. Pain in the lower abdomen or pelvis is not uncommon, especially during or after sexual intercourse. It can range from a mild ache to severe pain. Pain during sexual intercourse, dyspareunia, or painful sexual intercourse, is a symptom that some women with cervical cancer may experience. The pain can result from changes in the cervix caused by the growth of cancer cells. Leg pain or swelling. As the cancer progresses, it can press on nerves or blood vessels in the pelvis, leading to pain, swelling, or a feeling of heaviness in the legs. Difficulty urinating or defecating. Advanced cervical cancer can affect bladder and bowel function, leading to difficulty urinating, changes in the frequency of urination, or constipation. These symptoms occur when the cancer grows into nearby tissues and organs. Weight loss and fatigue. Unexplained weight loss and fatigue can be signs of many types of cancer, including cervical cancer. These symptoms occur as the body's resources are increasingly used to fight cancer. It's important to note that these symptoms can also be caused by conditions other than cervical cancer. However, if you experience any of these symptoms, especially if they persist, it's important to consult a healthcare professional for evaluation and diagnosis. But if you are stubborn and decide not to listen to me, just know that cervical cancer can lead to several complications, especially if it's not diagnosed and treated in its early stages. Which can be spread of cancer, metastasis. Cervical cancer can spread, metastasize, beyond the cervix to other parts of the body, such as the lungs, liver, bladder, vagina, and rectum, leading to new cancer sites that may affect the function of these organs. Kidney failure. Advanced cervical cancer can grow to block the ureters, the tubes that carry urine from the kidneys to the bladder. This blockage can lead to kidney failure, a condition where the kidneys lose their filtering ability. Kidney failure is serious and requires immediate medical attention. Fistula formation. A fistula is an abnormal opening between two organs or between an organ and the exterior of the body. In advanced cervical cancer, fistulas can form between the vagina and the rectum, rectovaginal fistula, or the bladder, vesicovaginal fistula, causing urine or feces to leak into the vagina, which can lead to distressing social and hygiene issues. I am very sure you don't want this at least. Problems with bowel and bladder function. The growth of cervical cancer can affect the bladder and rectum's normal function, leading to constipation, incontinence, or difficulty urinating. Bleeding. As the cancer progresses, it can cause heavy and potentially life-threatening bleeding from the vagina. This complication may require emergency treatment to control the bleeding. Lymphedema. Cancer or its treatment, especially surgery or radiation therapy, can affect lymph nodes and lymph vessels, leading to lymphedema, a condition characterized by swelling due to a blockage in the lymphatic system, most commonly affecting the legs. These complications underscore the importance of early detection and treatment of cervical cancer. By the way, if you have had cervical cancer in the past and defeated it, big congrats to you, and if you are still fighting the fight, good luck to you. I am strongly rooting for you. Please share your stories in the comment section. You might help or give hope to another soul. We have talked about screening and all that. How is it done and how exactly are you supposed to do it? Cervical cancer screening is a critical part of women's healthcare, designed to detect precancerous changes in the cervix that could develop into cancer if not treated. The primary screening tests include the Pap smear, Pap test, and the HPV test. These tests can identify abnormal cervical cells before they turn into cancer. The screening guidelines can vary by country, but they generally follow similar principles. Pap smear, Pap test. The Pap test involves collecting cells from the cervix, which are then examined under a microscope to look for precancerous or cancerous changes. It's been the traditional method for cervical cancer screening for decades. HPV test. The HPV test detects the presence of high-risk types of HPV in cervical cells, which are known to cause most cervical cancers. This test can be done alone or in combination with the Pap test, co-testing. About the screening guideline, I had to research to make sure it has not changed from what I know, and they are. Ages 21-29. Women should start having Pap tests every 3 years. HPV testing is not recommended in this age group unless needed after an abnormal Pap test result. Ages 30-65. Women have three options. Continue with Pap tests alone every 3 years. Get an HPV test alone every 5 years. Have a combination of a Pap test and an HPV test, co-testing, every 5 years. Over 65. Women who have had adequate prior screening and are not at high risk for cervical cancer may stop screening. Adequate prior screening typically means 3 consecutive negative Pap tests or 2 consecutive negative HPV tests within the last 10 years, with the most recent test within the past 5 years. After hysterectomy, women who have had a total hysterectomy, removal of the uterus and cervix, for reasons not related to cervical cancer or precancer, do not need to be screened. HPV vaccinated women. Women who have received the HPV vaccine should still follow the screening recommendations for their age groups because the vaccine does not protect against all HPV types that can cause cervical cancer. These guidelines emphasize the importance of regular screening as a part of preventive healthcare for women. It's essential for women to consult with their healthcare providers to determine the most appropriate screening schedule based on their health history and risk factors. Talking about preventive measures, I am sure it is now self-explanatory. Apart from these screenings, there is HPV vaccination. Target group. The HPV vaccine is recommended for girls and boys starting at ages 11 or 12, though it can be given as early as age 9. It's also recommended for unvaccinated individuals through age 26. Adults aged 27 through 45 years may decide to get the HPV vaccine after discussing their risk for new HPV infections and the potential benefits of vaccination with their healthcare provider. We know the other preventive measures. Raw sex is nice and all, but try to use a condom for your own safety and please try to keep only one partner. Quitting smoking might be hard, but give it a thought or at least reduce the frequency. Watch what you eat also. Eat foods rich in antioxidants and they help protect you from cancer. I am not going to tell you to hit the gym because I know you won't go, but please go for a morning or evening walk, take the stairs some days and avoid the elevator. That is all I need to tell you about preventing cervical cancer. So if you like, listen to me, and if you like, do what you want. My job is to make sure I equip you with the right health information, but I can't force you to listen. The next thing I want to talk about before treatment is the stages. Why? Because it is important for treatment. The treatment for stage 0 is different from stage 4. Cervical cancer stages range from 0 to IV, each indicating the extent to which the cancer has spread. Stage 0, carcinoma in situ. In this stage, abnormal cells are found in the innermost surface of the cervix. These cells may become cancerous and spread into nearby normal tissue. Stage 0 is also called carcinoma in situ. Stage 1, early stage. In this stage, the cancer has formed and is found in the cervix only. Stage 1 is divided into subcategories, 1A and 1B, based on the size of the tumor and the depth of invasion into the cervical tissue. 1A, a very small amount of cancer, visible only under a microscope, is found in the tissues of the cervix. 1B, a larger amount of cancer is present in the cervix. Stage 2. In stage 2, the cancer has spread beyond the cervix but not to the pelvic wall or to the lower third of the vagina. It's divided into 2A and 2B. Depending on whether the cancer has spread to nearby areas but not into the pelvic wall. 2A. Cancer has spread to the upper two-thirds of the vagina. 2B. Cancer has spread to the tissue around the cervix. Stage 3. Here the cancer has spread to the lower third of the vagina and or to the pelvic wall and or has caused kidney problems. It's divided into 3A and 3B. 3A. Cancer has spread to the lower third of the vagina but not to the pelvic wall. 3B. Cancer has spread to the pelvic wall and or caused kidney problems. Stage 4. Here the cancer has spread beyond the pelvis, or can be seen in the lining of the bladder or rectum, or has spread to other parts of the body. It's divided into 4A and 4B also. 4A. Cancer has spread to the bladder or rectal lining but not to distant sites. 4B. Cancer has spread to distant organs beyond the pelvic area, such as the lungs, liver, or bones. With the stages in mind, let's talk about treatment and management. The treatment of cervical cancer depends on several factors, including the stage of the cancer like I said earlier, the size of the tumor, the patient's age, and general health status. Treatment options typically include surgery, radiation therapy, chemotherapy, targeted therapy, and immunotherapy. Let's start with S-surgery. Surgery is often used for early-stage cervical cancer. Types of surgery include conization, removal of a cone-shaped piece of tissue from the cervix and cervical canal, also used for diagnosis and treatment of precancerous conditions. LEAP, loop electrosurgical excision procedure, uses electricity to remove abnormal tissue. Hysterectomy, removal of the uterus and cervix. In early stages, a simple hysterectomy, removal of the uterus and cervix only, may suffice. For more advanced cancer, a radical hysterectomy, which also involves removal of part of the vagina and surrounding tissues, may be necessary. Trachelectomy, removal of the cervix but preserving the uterus, an option for women who wish to maintain fertility. Radiation therapy. Radiation therapy uses high-energy rays to kill cancer cells. It can be external beam radiation therapy, EBRT, where radiation is directed at the cancer from a machine outside the body, or brachytherapy, internal radiation, where radioactive material is placed directly into or near the cancer. Often used for all stages of cervical cancer, especially when surgery is not an option, or in combination with chemotherapy as a primary treatment or to reduce the risk of recurrence. Chemotherapy. Chemotherapy uses drugs to kill cancer cells, usually administered intravenously. It can be used alongside radiation therapy as a radiosensitizer, to make cancer cells more sensitive to radiation, or alone to treat advanced cervical cancer. Chemotherapy is systemic, meaning it can affect cancer cells throughout the body. Targeted therapy. Targeted therapy focuses on specific molecules involved in the growth, progression, and spread of cancer, blocking their effects. Bevacizumab, Avastin, for example, is a targeted therapy that stops the formation of new blood vessels that tumors need to grow, angiogenesis inhibitor, and is used to treat advanced cervical cancer in combination with chemotherapy. Immunotherapy. Immunotherapy helps to boost the body's immune system to fight cancer. Pembrolizumab, Keytruda, is an immunotherapy drug approved for treating advanced cervical cancer that is not responding to chemotherapy and expresses PD-L1, a protein that helps cancer cells avoid being detected by the immune system. The choice of treatment is highly individualized and based on a thorough discussion between the patient and the healthcare team, considering the benefits and risks of each option. Advances in treatment and care have significantly improved the prognosis and quality of life for many women with cervical cancer. Do not underestimate the effect of a good diet, rest, exercise, and stress-relieving practices like meditation. If you have been watching my videos, you will know that I love meditation. It changed my life, so I won't stop talking about it. In conclusion, cervical cancer remains a significant health challenge for women worldwide, but it is also one of the most preventable forms of cancer today. Through a comprehensive approach that includes HPV vaccination, regular screening, safe sexual practices, smoking cessation, and a healthy lifestyle, we have the power to significantly reduce the incidence and impact of this disease. I hope this video has been informative and enlightening, offering valuable insights into the causes, risk factors, symptoms, and complications of cervical cancer, as well as the crucial steps that can be taken to prevent it. Your health and well-being are important, and taking proactive steps towards cancer prevention can make a significant difference. Thank you so much for watching this video. If you found it helpful, please give it a like to support our channel. Don't forget to subscribe for more informative content like this. Your engagement helps us to reach and educate more people, contributing to a healthier, more informed community. Remember, early detection and prevention are key. We encourage you to talk to your healthcare provider about HPV vaccination and the appropriate cervical cancer screening schedule for you. Together, we can make a difference in the fight against cervical cancer. Thank you for your time, and please stay healthy and informed.